morning. We heard about and we discussed about almost all the oral agents and injectables, metformin, DPP-4 inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors, GLP, insulins, basal, prandial, everything. But we have the older agent, which is none other than sulfonylurea. It still remains the mainstream in management of type 2 diabetes. And to hear about more regarding the use, safety, and concerns of sulfonylurea, we have very prolific speaker, none other than Dr. Sarida Bajaj. She was very busy these days, traveling all the conferences, giving lectures. She is a director, professor, and head of the medicine, MLN Medical College, Allahabad. President, South Asian Federation of Endocrine Society. President of Women in Endocrinology and Diabetes. And last year, RSST 8 2015, it was well applauded and appreciated for her scientific chair position in RSST 8 2015. And she has more than hundreds of publications in national and international journals. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, respected chairperson, for those kind words. A very good morning to you. And after Abdesh's powerful lecture, it's a poor woman here who's going to give you a talk about a poor man's, possibly what people might say, a poor man's drug. But what is left to me is to prove whether this old drug, the oldest one that has been available with us, old is gold or platinum or even maybe higher titanium. So let's see if I can prove some points in favor of sulfonylureas. Okay, so I've already said they are old drugs, but they are being neglected to some extent because we have many, many more drugs available in the armamentarium. So, should we continue to prescribe them the way they were being prescribed, or do we choose the other agents that are now available? So we need to have just a little bit of a relook at that data. Okay, this is a very important national list of essential medicines. Right, this came out in 2015, and you can see that the drug, because this statement of ours, the safe and smart sulfonylureas, was the consensus statement. We started off and we finished it in Bangladesh, Dhaka, in April 2015. So that is why you'll find that we have listed here the five South Asian countries, which are included in the South Asian Federation. That is Bangladesh, India, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Now, as you will see in India, it is glimepiride that is listed in the national list of essential medicines. Okay, you'll be surprised to know that dolbutamide, which I think that a lot of you would never even have had the chance to prescribe, is still available in the government sector in Bangladesh. So I think that is something that might be news to you, because I have used it, but a lot of you would never even have used it. Now, if we try to classify the sulfonylureas, you will note that the conventional ones are also listed here. It is the modern ones that are of importance, that is glimepiride, gliclazide, and gliclazide MR. Okay? So these are the ones that are better as compared to the earlier ones, the conventional ones, and I will be giving you reasons for that. Sulfonylureas all across board in all the guidelines, whether it's ADA, ESD, whether it's IDF, NICE guidelines, even in Asia, the Japan and China guidelines, sulfonylureas are still being recommended as second line. Okay, so they are still being recommended. And remember, when metformin is contraindicated, then they may be used as first line, as you can see in the NICE guidelines. What it says is prescribe a sulf-SU with a low acquisition cost, not glibenclamide. I'll come to reasons for that. But you can consider it as an option for first line if you want a rapid response because of severe symptoms of hyperglycemia, osmotic diuresis. The RSSTI guidelines, again, which came out late 2015, and they are the Indian guidelines that we have to start off with a sulfonylurea as second line when glucose control targets are not being achieved, okay? So you can have dual therapy sometimes to start off, but usually as second line therapy, what the Indian guidelines are recommending. Okay, so much so about what the guidelines are telling us, what is happening in South Asia. But the rest of my talk is based on these points. So the pharmacology and efficacy of the SUs. Remember that they're not all the same. They act on different receptors and they have different selectivity. This is extremely important to understand. As you can see, if you look at the pancreatic beta cell, glycoside, glimepiride, glibenclamide are all acting there. Glibenclamide all across board, the cardiac skeletal muscle, vascular smooth muscle, non-vascular smooth muscle, right? So there are different sites of action as far as the receptors are concerned, number one. If I was talking about the modern SUs, glimepiride specifically binds to the 65 KDA protein, unlike the conventional sulfonylureas, and compared to glibenclamide, it exhibits a lower binding affinity for the sulfonylurea receptor. So this is another very important difference. When we come to glycoside, one distinct difference is it does not bind to EPACT2, which is a stimulating factor for insulin exocytosis. So these subtle differences need to be remembered. The additional advantage is that glimepiride improves both the first and the second phase of insulin secretion. The extra pancreatic action of glimepiride is due to decrease in insulin resistance along with increased expression of the GLUT2 transporters. Now, the modern SUs, again, that is glimepiride and glycoside, are therefore more selective for the beta cell, unlike the conventional sulfonylureas, that is glibenclamide. So the comparator is mainly glibenclamide. And unlike glibenclamide, glimepiride does not block the beneficial effect of the mitochondrial potassium ATP channel. So this blunting of the so-called ischemic preconditioning with glibenclamide is not seen with glimepiride. Okay, so this is extremely important. As far as this difference is very, very important when we come to the cardiac safety. Undoubtedly, when you add a sulfonylurea, or if you compare it to metformin, which is the gold standard in all the guidelines, it is the first drug to start off with. The efficacy is high. Yes, reasonably well tolerated. The hypoglycemia risk, again, it is much less with the modern sulfonylureas. Some weight gain, definitely, but I will be addressing that later as well. I'll be addressing the CV safety, and we all know that it is definitely cheaper as compared to the other drugs. Now, if we just discuss the monotherapy, what do we expect as the fall in plasma glucose? So the fasting plasma glucose may fall up to 70 milligrams, and you can have as high as a 2% reduction in A1C. None of the other oral anti-diabetic agents is able to achieve this HbA1c reduction. So that is again a very, very big point in favor of the efficacy of sulfonylureas. Again, this is very interesting meta-analysis in which the conclusions are mentioned here regarding the reduction in the A1C levels in the context of glimepiride compared to DPP-4, It had a 12% greater reduction. And the meta-analysis showed a favorable result for glimepiride with an odds ratio of 1.14. The association of glimepiride metformin produced a greater reduction than DPP-4 metformin combination. There were significantly fewer dropouts, only 50% in the glimepiride group compared to DPP-4 group. Hypoglycemia with glimepiride was mild or moderate. Severe, only 1.2%, and the weight change difference was not more than 2 kilograms. Again, we have a recent study, the GUIDE study, which was a double-blind comparison of once daily gliclazide with glimepiride. Numerically, there was a 2% greater reduction in A1C, 0.2% greater reduction in A1C on glimepiride, and there were no episodes of severe hypoglycemia which were reported in the patients who were included in the study. If we have a real life practice study, that is Sanjay Kalra's work, that is in the obstacle study, in which 33 centers over 1,000 patients for more than 12 weeks, only 5 patients had the highest observed hypoglycemia score of 6. So they used the Stanford scoring, which is actually designed in Spanish. However, they translated it into English. There are 7 points which are used to hypoglycemia score. That is not validated in English, but nevertheless, that is the only one that was available to score. The most commonly prescribed sulfonylurea was glimepiride, that is in 75%, gliclazide in 12%, and the mean hypoglycemia score was much lesser in glimepiride in this study as compared to gliclazide. Now, if you add a sulfonylurea to metformin, what is the weight change? Now, what they showed here is that the primary outcome was within drug yearly change in body weight after receiving add-on therapy with individual sulfonylureas during the 5-year follow-up. Again, the conclusion in patients with diabetes treated in primary care, strict glycemic control can be maintained with sulfonylureas used as an add-on therapy without the offset of the relative weight changes, which always worry us. So weight gain, if it is there, it will stabilize by 6 months. It's not going to go on. It's not going to be 10 kilos, 15 kilos. What Avdesh was referring to was the tremendous weight gain which we see with pioglitazone. Here, the weight gain probably reflects the anabolic effects of increased plasma insulin concentrations together with the reduced loss of glucose in the urine. Now, moving on to the second part, the beta cell function preservation. Again, do sulfonylureas actually cause loss of beta cell? Okay, do we have data there? Again, beta cell per se is a progressive phenomenon in the natural history of type 2 diabetes. And probably about 50% is already lost at the time of diagnosis in a pre-diabetic as well. The durability, it was shown in the UKPDS perspective, it was not different in sulfonylureas as compared to metformin. They appeared neither to increase nor to decrease the underlying rate of loss of beta cell function. Again, another study here, 2010, decreasing the postprandial C-peptide level, which is a good marker of insulin reserve, over time is not associated with long-term use. So we have data which supports the fact that the beta cell loss is not because of sulfonylureas. The CV safety, again, that's extremely important. For all drugs that are now available, it is mandatory to show the CV safety. Again, the legacy effect of intensive sulfonylureas versus insulin therapy Again, there was glucose similar, but the CV events were shown to be lesser. So UKPDS did not support the idea that sulfonylureas were associated with an increased risk of death. Similarly, in the VADT follow-up study, there was a 17% relative reduction in the rate of CV events. Even in the advance and the advance on data, after the completion, patients could discontinue their assigned treatment in this study. And again, there was no evidence of any CV risk associated. Now, if we show comparative trials with the modern sulfonylureas and the conventional sulfonylureas regarding the CV safety, glipizide versus glimepiride, in patients with established CAD, glimepiride showed lesser overall mortality compared to glibenclamide, which is also called gliburide. It's the same thing, just different name. Again, the outcome data, mortality among secretagogues. This was a retrospective observational cohort, 2002 consecutive type 2 diabetics, 3-year mortality in diabetic patients treated with different combinations of insulin secretagogues and metformin. It was shown that the modern sulfonylureas were associated with a lower risk of all-cause and cardiovascular-related mortality. Again, the comparator is glibenclamide. So I have established that they are efficacious. They do not cause beta cell loss. And they are relatively CV safe. So how should you pragmatically prescribe them? What should be the patients? Very important. Patient selection is extremely important for any drug to continue on a long term. Dosage selection, how should the patient be empowered, and physician empowerment is what we are also addressing here. So if you are going to have them as initial therapy, as monotherapy, if the patient has a contraindication to metformin, you could combine them in initial therapy with metformin with severe hyperglycemia at presentation. You know, we can add them as second line once metformin glucose control is inadequate, subsequent inadequate glycemic control. Again, special considerations for the elderly, for patients with renal impairment. We know that neonatal diabetes, sometimes they have an excellent response to sulfonylurea and MODY3. Ramadan, I will be addressing again. And if there is fasting hyperglycemia, you would prefer a longer acting sulfonylurea. And if there is postprandial hyperglycemia, you would prefer a shorter acting sulfonylurea. Always remember, with sulfonylureas, we do not start off in a newly diagnosed with a TDS BD prescription. Start low, step up slowly, and titrate upwards once in 2 weeks for responders or once a week for non-responders. The timing should be before the first and the subsequent major meal of the day. Patients and family members should be educated. So this is very important. Hypoglycemia education here is very, very important. Shorter acting drugs like glipizide should be preferred in patients with moderate or severe renal impairment. Mild, moderate renal impairment, glicizide and glimepiride may be used, but at lower doses. Again, for mild and moderate impairment, hepatic impairment, you can reduce the dose and continue them. With a lower risk of hypoglycemia, like glicizide modified release and glimepiride for the elderly, and they are not indicated as of now in children and adolescents, and definitely not in pregnancy and lactation. Now, in Ramadan, I said I would again address this issue. Use of third generation and modified or extended release sulfonylureas should be preferred in fasting type 2 diabetic patients, as they have a lower risk of hypoglycemia. So this is the consensus statement which I was addressing to. And remember that whenever you're going to prescribe them safely and smartly, always keep the patient-centered approach. And remember, after what I have been addressing in my talk, patients should not be deprived of the advantages of this well-established class of anti-diabetic agents. I would like to conclude by saying that I have given you enough evidence that trials support acceptable risk of hypoglycemia with safe and smart use. They are definitely not all the same. I told you about the different binding to the sulfonylurea receptor. It does not cause beta cell decline, and CV safety has also been established. There's a neutral effect of the sulfonylurea. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, dear Sarida Vijay, ma'am.
I agree with you. Yeah, but then I didn't show you the data on diclizide. They're both CV safe. So between the two, I would not differentiate.
Ma'am, we have seen certain situations like combining sulfonylureas.
Okay. You mean using a glipizide glimepiride? That is absolutely illogical because the mechanism of action is exactly the same. So one would never do that in the same prescription.
Among the conventional sulfonylureas, what is the current status of chlorpropamide?
Oh, chlorpropamide has gone long. Diabetes, the patients were hooked onto it at one point in time. It was such an excellent glucose lowering. So chlorpropamide is not available and we would not discuss it. It used to cause that chlorpropamide alcohol flush and very severe. This, when we talk of the repeated hypoglycemia, that is the one drug that was most notorious. It could last up to 7 to 9 days. Thankfully, it's not available any longer. When we talk of the advantages, we talk of the MR, the glycoside modified release. That would be equal to glimepiride. So in that respect, your question, the answer would be, if I have to choose which of the two you said, between glimepiride and glycoside, it would be glycoside modified release. Right? That is the so-called modern sulfonylurea. No, the advantages are with the modified release preparation. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So, given the fact that the clinical concerns of sulfonylurea are agent-specific and we have to select the agents according to patients and keep it very safely using while controlling blood sugars, considering all the aspects which we have
all drugs, that applies to all, especially to sulfonylureas. Yeah. That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.